city is permanent.
No, the city is temporal.
The city is made of permanent temporalities.
No, the city is made of bricks and people.
And this is Elma, my pleasantly critical love of my life.
This is my soulmate and partner in crime, Christian. I think that. And immediately when we met, we shared this deep fascination for the city. And unfortunately, we found ourselves in the picturesque city of Arnhem, where life was calm and dull and a little bit boring. But we were searching for some adventure, so we moved to Rotterdam. The city, being seduced by its fascinating history and the place where the city is seen as a laboratory with these big open public spaces, windy, and a no-nonsense mentality. When we arrived, we found out that this was a city designed for cars and not for people. While not so long ago, exactly at the same place, it was like this. It was the most energetic part of the city of Rotterdam, with jazz bars and a lively city culture. What happened? And what could we learn from it?
So we took those lessons, and in the last 18 years, we were able to revive this part of town with a lot of help from entrepreneurs, municipality, and this few minutes, we will try to compress those 18 years and tell the adventures in the city of permanent temporality, in which we were able to get people on the streets again.
In the year 2000, we moved into this building. It was vacant. It didn't have any proper tenant for at least 10 years.
Well, some mice and rats, obviously.
And our studio view was this: infrastructure and leftover space.
But to give you a bit of context how this all happened, we have to go back 70 years to the moment that Rotterdam was severely bombed, and the only remains was this station, Hofplein, and in a vast open landscape of devastation. But the city was so eager to make a modernist city, so they were drawing all these blueprints, and genius master planner Van Traa was able almost solely to plan out a whole new city, in which he precisely laid out, this is where you work, that's where you live, and that's where you recreate, in these beautiful drawings. So, as drawn, they also produced this, like for 1 million inhabitants to come. Up till now, they didn't come yet. But also lots of cars. And also the big multinationals moved in, like Shell, Texaco, but we still had this reindeer camp. That's Rotterdam in its best contrast.
Years later, the multinationals moved out and the office building became vacant. And maybe it's because that the public space wasn't really designed for the people. In the same time, the municipality and the owners made some new plans for building extra offices. It's what you could call Excel sheet urbanism.
But so far so good, but as soon as these plans start to affect our house, our block, they want to demolish the whole block, we could no longer just sit and wait. Obviously, without too much sleep, we were getting out of our bunker and start to campaign for transformation of the area right now, using temporal interventions. We really had to do something.
Of course, we were also we could imagine that densification would be good for the area, but why wouldn't we use the existing and add some new on top? And have a marriage between the local and the global?
And the idea was simple, like traditional city making is, we have a part of the city, we demolish a whole part, and then we build something new. It'll take 20 years. But we thought, why not start with the existing qualities, the existing buildings, the existing users, and just like evolution, grow this city based on its qualities.
So we didn't wait, but we just started. We opened up the facade of the building, just using some paint and help from our friends. And within 3 weeks, we made this city, this debate part of an exhibition part in the city, where different cultural institutes start programming. And in no time, it was a local hangout. Perhaps it was because we just had our daughter, who's taking a nap at this moment, that we thought that this place needed a human touch.
And from the corner, we imagined the whole building could be one big laboratory with studios and public functions. So this was our Excel sheet, our business case. We presented to the municipality and the developers. And, well, they said, okay, and here we are opening up the urban laboratory of the Schieblok. And within no time, we had a beautiful building in its natural environment, in its natural existence. But more importantly, not just the building, but it was now home for 80 young entrepreneurs who would now be able to work in the midst of the city, start their business.
We opened up the whole plinth and programmed it as a platform for city culture, inviting more people to get this buzz on the street. But not everybody was liking it, as you see in this picture. Bikers weren't happy.
No, they always like to really speed their bikes, so they were a little bit agitated. All of a sudden, there were people on the streets again. But in order to make that clear, we started to put furniture and started to paint the streets to make clear this is no longer just a space for cars and bikes, but for people to be and to relax. And meanwhile, we're doing these one-to-one interventions on the ground. We also work with the community on the larger idea of the plan. And we call this a one-to-one model, a test site. And the idea was simple. You can have these great ambitions and dreams, but if they're not tested in reality, they just stay dreams. So we had this loop of thinking and designing and testing and adapting and allowing ourselves to make mistakes and to learn from those mistakes. And with all those projects, we called it a test site. And we had 20 imaginary projects in the area, and they were divided as routing, placemaking, transformation, densification, and local economy. And they were all temporal projects with an alliance and a business case and a design. And now, up to now, we are counting like almost 70 projects, which, as a kind of acupuncture, are reviving this part of town.
And one of the first projects was really simple, just painting a zebra on the street. Another project, we asked the owner of the building if we could have some of his budget for the demolition to open it up and make a passage. Another project was on the roof of the Schieblok, making the first productive roof landscape of Europe here. But these were still some small interventions, and we were wondering how could we connect them and what can we do to make this backbone of projects. And we invented the Luchtsingel.
But what do you do if you don't have any money? It was crisis, by the way. So we imagined, let's just build what we can fund, and then we'll see if we ever will finish this bridge. And the idea was simple. We have a wooden footbridge. If we divide it in 17,000 planks, we can start to sell them one by one. Everybody can, for 25 euros only, can have their name, their tweet, or their wish on it. And the alderman bought the first one, obviously from her own pocket money. And many were following and making the ornaments of the bridge.
And we didn't design it as infrastructure. We designed it as a place to stay, a place to hang out. This former known backside area of the city, which was dominated by fences and containers, just in a few years, 4 years' time, is a place for people to gather, a place which is where there are now the hotspots of the city, like Annabelle, the beer garden and bar. Yeah.
But that was just the start, because we were still in our little cocoon around the Schieblok, but we wanted to make bigger connections, like connect the one part of the Schiekade, which we had to overcome with the first part of the bridge, going through the Schieblok, but also connecting to the former headquarters of Shell, which was already empty for 20 years. So all of a sudden, we were able to connect three parts of the city which were disconnected since the war, and one of the last remains of the bombing was finally turning into a front side of the city and no longer this neglected backside.
And one of our last projects that we did was also one of the remaining parts after the Second World War. It was designing and activating the roof of the former train station, the Hofplein, and we made it into a public park, a place where people could just stay, where it was able to program small events, but also which has a communal garden where you can help out. It's a place where you just can view the nice city skyline, or catch some sun, or watch a movie at night.
So after all these 18 years, we now finally made everybody convinced that this part of town really does matter. The existing buildings do matter. The people who are already making this into a nice place do matter. So now with municipality developers and users, we're thinking about the next stage for the area and starting with these existing qualities.
Our daughter is not sleeping anymore in her buggy. She's now 10 years old. And that also shows it how fast time goes, but also how slowly urban transformation is.
It's really the small steps we make by temporalities, but creating a massive permanent transformation. And in order to remind ourselves and not to forget, we, together with all the partners we have worked with the last 18 years, we create the book in order to share that knowledge and share the experience and inspire everybody that, well, take also your part of your city into your hands.
And also to remind ourselves that a city is always incomplete and always unfinished.
Thank you.
Thank you.